wabarakatuh. My name is Siti Fatih Khadijah binti Mama Ibrahim. I will explain the introduction of fish and seafood. Fish is a aquatic vertebrate that are typically an ectotherm meat, which is mean cold blood. It equipped with two set of paraffin and several unparaffin. Fisheries is 60% of world population protein. Type of edible fish species is such as tuna, salmon, and anchovies. Shellfish is a colloquial and fisheries term for exoskeleton, including various species of mollusks, crustacean, and echinoderm. Composition and nutritive value of fish. Various tissue of seafood products such as muscle, roe, stomach, kidney, liver, skin, and feet. Chemical composition is varies greatly from species to species depend on age, sex, environment, and season. Type of chemical composition is water, protein, fat, and minor composition which is contain carbohydrate, mineral, vitamin, and extractive.
Hari ni kita orang akan bincang tajuk protein dengan MPN. Okay, muscle tissue ada dua bahagian, iaitu protein dengan MPN. Muscle tissue terbahagi kepada tiga, iaitu sarcoplasmic, myofibrilla dan juga stroma. Sarcoplasmic adalah water soluble, myofibrilla adalah salt soluble, dan stroma soluble in water and salt. Okay, gabungan protein dengan MPN adalah crude protein. Untuk sarcoplasmic, dia adalah water soluble, dan enzim dan oksigen carrier, dan hemoprotein adalah myoglobin dan juga hemoglobin. Ia akan interfere with myosin, cross linking during gel matrix formation, and do not form gel and poor WHC. WHC itu adalah water holding capacity. Okay, yang kedua adalah myofibrilla. Myofibrilla adalah composed by actin and myosin. 60-80% adalah total protein. Proportion dia adalah total muscle protein, higher than in land animal. Okay, lepas tu adalah stroma. Stroma ni adalah insoluble in water and salt, remaining after removing sarcoplasmic dan juga myofibrilla protein. Dia ada connective tissue. Connective tissue dia adalah dua, collagen dengan elastin. Lepas tu, non-protein nitrogenous compound. Non-protein nitrogenous compound ni adalah content in seafood higher than other food Maya system. Okay, importance dia ada dua. First, influence unique and delicate taste of seafood, and second, contribute to the spoilage of fishery product. Okay, lepas tu kita akan masuk pada lipid. Lipid terbahagi kepada tiga, iaitu depot fat, phospholipid dan juga kolesterol. Okay, untuk depot fat tu, bila dia lebih daripada 1%, dia dikira sebagai energy. Dia adalah long chain fatty acid, iaitu unsaturated. Kalau dalam fish, dalam banyak fatty acid dengan 5 atau 6 double bond. Okay, dark muscle fish ni lagi tinggi triglyceride daripada white muscle, dan dia senang oxidize. Dan untuk omega 3, dia adalah member of linolenic acid yang dia membantu dalam pertumbuhan growth promoting in children. Seterusnya adalah phospholipid. Kalau phospholipid, 1% of fish muscle. Dia adalah essential structural part of cell. Dan dia non-depot lipids, phospholipid adalah phosphorus nitrogen containing fat. Dia bukan function sebagai energy reserve, dan dia tak distribute unevenly dalam tissue. Okay, next yang ketiga tu kolesterol. Kolesterol adalah main sterol in fish muscle and not much higher in mammalian tissue. Lepas tu, yang last sekali adalah vitamin and mineral. Dia adalah kalau macam dalam fish meat, dia good source in vitamin B and C, and kalau dalam fatty species, dia higher dalam vitamin A and D. Lepas tu, kalau dalam salt water, dia contain higher iodine.
Assalamualaikum, nama saya Nurul Anis. Saya akan present mengenai postmortem changes in fish. So postmortem changes in fish ada tiga, which is rigor mortis, arteriosis changes and fat oxidation. So in raw fish, kita ambil kira tentang appearance, odor, texture and taste. So during storage, kualiti yang kita akan tengok adalah tentang appearance and texture, while taste akan develop the first couple of days during storage in ice. So selepas ikan itu mati, the muscle will be totally relaxed, which is akan soft, firm dan elastic to touch. But after a few hours, muscle will be contract and it becomes stiff, and the whole body will be inflexible, which is we call it as rigor mortis. After a few days, rigor will be resolved. So muscle akan relax balik and become limp but not elastic. So factors that affect the rate of onset and resolution of rigo is species, temperature, catching method, handling, size and physical condition of fish. And then, rigor mortis is important in filleting industry. So in rigo, usually muscle of the fish is in good quality, but the machine filleting is more difficult because the muscle of the fish is stiff. So as a result, the yield will be lower. And then in principle, it is safer to fillet fish in post-rigo. Rigor mortis start immediately if fish is stuffed, glycogen receive depleted and fish is stressed. Bukan tu je, stunning and killing by hypothermia also akan menjadikan rigo to start immediately. So if the fish is cooked at pre-rigo, the muscle will be very soft and it will be very soft, texture and pasty. In rigo, the flesh will be tough but not dry. While in post-rigo, the flesh becomes firm and elastic. Thank you.
So kita akan teruskan dengan changes yang seterusnya, iaitu autolytic changes. So autolytic changes ni ialah self-digestion. So the self-digestion ni dia adalah breakdown of animal tissue. So semasa digestion ni dia ada two types of spoilage, sama ada bacteria spoilage ataupun enzymatic spoilage. So kalau biasanya kalau bila organisme mati, dia punya normal regulation system ni dia akan stop to function. So bila masa tu dia akan supply of oxygen dengan energy tu dia akan stop. Bila masa tu dia akan start new process, iaitu breakdown of glycogen. So ataupun kita panggil sebagai glycolysis. And then waktu tu the degradation of energy rich compound akan berlaku. Untuk breakdown of glycogen tu, dia punya normal pathway dia akan jadi CO2 tambah H2O dia tambah ATP. So untuk anaerobic condition, ATP tu dia akan pergi pada dua pathway, iaitu creatine phosphate dengan arginine phosphate. Untuk anaerobic muscle dia tak boleh maintain dia punya normal level of ATP tu. So ATP dia akan, level tu dia akan drop. Bila drop, dia muscle tu dia akan berlaku rigor mortis. Macam yang explain tadi, rigor mortis tu adalah stiffening of joint and muscle. So glycolysis juga dia akan berlaku proses accumulation of lactic acid. So dia akan, kesannya dia akan lowers the pH of muscle lah. Untuk different fish, dia akan ada different level of pH sebab accumulation of lactic acid ni dia bergantung pada amount of glycogen dalam fish. So setiap fish dia akan ada different glycogen amount lah. So kalau untuk contoh macam ikan, dia akan pH dia lagi low daripada mammals lah sebab dia low glycogen. So untuk nucleotide metabolism ni, untuk dia punya softening of muscle, muscle berlaku rigor mortis tu. Masa ni macam masa spoilage lah, spoilage of fish tu. So dia punya proses ni dia coincidental dengan autolytic changes ataupun kita panggil ATP degradation. So masa ATP degradation tu dia akan degrade kepada ADP, seterusnya AMP, IMP, inosin dan last kali hypoxanthin. So yang molekul last ni, hypoxanthin ni, ia adalah dia hasilkan bitter of flavour pada spoiled fish. Itu yang bagus. Of flavour. So, different fish dia ada different speed of degradation. Untuk kalau from autolytic change ni, daripada proses tadi yang ATP semua tu hasilkan hypoxanthin tu, kita boleh dapatkan formula untuk freshness of fish. Itu kita panggil K value lah. K tu sama dengan freshness index. So, berdasarkan K value tu, kita boleh tahu kalau K tinggi, dia punya freshness tu akan rendah. Freshness of fish. So, autolytic changes ni dia involve juga dalam proto-lytic enzyme. So proto-lytic ni dia breakdown yang related pada extensive softening of tissue. Contohnya macam belly bursting. Itulah untuk proto-lytic ni. Kalau masa frozen storage pula, dia berlaku autolytic yang akan hasilkan formaldehyde. Formaldehyde ni, kesan dia masa tu jadi hitam. So untuk elakkan berlaku formaldehyde dekat fish tu, kita kena make sure kita buang dulu organ tissue ikan tu, contohnya macam kidney. Lepas tu kita kena store fish tu dalam suhu kurang daripada negatif 30 degree Celsius untuk elakkan berlaku formaldehyde. So seterusnya untuk bacteriological changes, yang ni dia berkenaan dengan pertumbuhan bakteria flora dalam live fish. Yang ni dia berlaku dekat skin, gills dengan intestine lah. So contoh spoilage compound yang menyebabkan bacteria spoilage ni, change ni, adalah contoh Pseudomonas species ataupun anaerobic spoilers. So yang last kali, changes yang boleh berlaku dekat ikan ialah lipid oxidation dan hydrolysis. So akan ada dua, auto-oxidation ataupun dan repeat autolysis. Kalau auto-oxidation ni dia berlaku bila ada kehadiran oksigen dengan unsaturated lipid. So kehadiran ni dia akan memproduce ketol, aldehyde, free radicals dengan dan hasilkan oxidative density. Kalau repeat autolysis ni dia berlaku enzyme dehydrolysis. So dia akan produce free fatty acid, glycerol, lepas tu dia akan menyebabkan hydrolytic density.
Okay, my name is Siti Nasara binti Muhammad Zaki and I will explain about freezing and chilling. What is freezing? Freezing is the process of preservation at which the temperature is lower. If the temperature is low, the spoilage will be retarded, and if the temperature is too lower, the spoilage will be stopped. The second is rigor mortis. What is rigor mortis? Rigor mortis is the stiffening of joint and muscle of the body a few hours after death, about 1 until 4 days. If we cut the muscle during or before the rigor mortis, the fillet will be shrink. Type of temperature. The first temperature is rapid freezing. Rapid freezing is the cooling could disrupt and tear the muscle tissue. The second is slow freezing. Slow freezing is the formation of large ice crystal and damaged cell. The freezing point of fish is about negative 1 to negative 2 degrees Celsius. Optimal range of protein denaturation. Negative 1 to negative 5 degrees Celsius is known as critical or freezing zone. The third is quick freezing. Quick freezing is reduce the temperature from 0 to negative 5 degrees Celsius in 2 hours or less. Okay, the second I will explain about chilling. Chilling is the process temperature of fish is lower to point near freezing but not below it. If the temperature change, it will give a greater impact on microbial growth. If different temperature, the shelf life is expressed as relative rate of spoilage. RRS is also known as keeping time at 0 degrees Celsius over keeping time of time at degrees Celsius. Fish is difficult to fillet if the WHC is lower. Rapid chilling is very crucial for quality of fish. If fish is exposed direct to the sun and wind for 4 until 6 hours before chilling, the oxidation of lipid will happen and will lead to rancidity and off flavor. Yes.
Okay, so fish products, in the sea, there's like 100% of fish, right? So 70%, 72% of those fishes are caught by humans for consumption. That's a lot, right? But there is about 31% from that 72% that is used for later consumption. Later consumption? How? Means they are not eaten fresh. But if fish is not eaten fresh, how can it be eaten? Don't worry, technology has it all. So, we can preserve the fish. How? What way can we do it? We can dry it, we can thaw it, we can slow it, ferment, canning, make it as sashimi, cooking, freezing, and adding value to the fish, means like adding nutrients or some sort of to make the fish last longer. Okay, what is drying? Drying is the process where we remove the water from the fish to extend the shelf life of the fish. We can compare a dried fish and a fresh fish. Which one will deteriorate and get bad easily, get bad faster? Okay, for drying, usually there are three types of drying, which is air drying, vacuum drying, and freeze drying. Okay, salting, fish salting. What is fish salting? You know, if you are not familiar with fish salting, you might as well just think that you just throw in the fish in a beaker, and then you pour the salt, and then it's done. But no, it's not like that. First, you must cut the head of the fish, and then you must throw away the gut. You must, throw away the gut. And then, why do we need to throw away the gut? Because even in our gut, there's bacteria. It's dirty. And if we keep the fish guts, it will produce bad taste. And also, we never know if the bacteria is still alive even after we already salt it, even though it is in high water concentration. Because certain bacteria can withstand high salinity, means high concentration of salt. So, to be safe, we remove the guts. Okay. And then make sure when salting the fish, we coat the salt properly inside, outside, and everywhere around the fish. Okay, be sure to be safe. Okay, next one, surimi. Many of you wonder, what is surimi? Surimi is mechanically a deboned fish flesh that is washed with water and mixed with cryoprotectants for good frozen shelf life. So, surimi is mainly from Japan. Okay, we all know it based on the name. But surimi is often produced from low-value white flesh fish with typical yield of 25 to 28% of the body weight of the fish. So we have a few processes of making surimi. So we have this, like, imagine this is a whole fish. We shed it and we gut it. Gut it means removing the gut. And then we do the meat separation by mincing. and then we wash it. After we wash it, we dewatering it. What is dewatering? Means straining the fish. Of course, after wash, you need to strain the fish to get the flesh right. And then we need to mix it with cryoprotectants and forming it into blocks and freeze, and then package it into cardboard box and we keep it in under cold temperature. Remember, cold temperature. Cold temperature, low water humidity. Okay. Okay. Surimi based products. Surimi based product is made possible because of gel formation due to the presence of actin and myosin. So when heated at moderate temperature, the protein react to form actomyosin gel. According to Japanese, a good resilient texture is called ashi. Okay, what is resilient texture? Okay, try to pinch your arm. It's quite soft, right? So upper arm is quite resilient. I don't know. I don't know about you, but mine is quite resilient if I beat my fist. So this is ashi. And then the surimi has made sometimes they add colors and flavors so that they can produce varieties of surimi types. You know, like we have, for example, we have rice, we have potato. Some make it into chips, some make it into french fries, some make it into wiggly fries. You know, just the variations that will attract the customer. So, the quality of surimi. Japan is really, 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 really considers, really, it is a priority for Japanese to have this good color and the blandness of flavor from surimi. Means if the surimi is not attractive in color, they won't buy it. And then the next, it is the gel formation, which is the actin and myosin properties. As I said earlier, it must have this ashy texture, okay? And then other tests to see that if the surimi is of good quality is by pH test and drip loss and viscosity test. So the gel quality is measured to reflect the quality of raw material, the effect of washing cycles in concentrating the actin and myosin, and any changes brought about by frozen storage. So gel formation is quite important because actin and myosin is made of protein, so it cannot be in such a hot temperature or else the protein will denature. So it is really important to make sure that the surimi is kept just at the right temperature so that it will not surimi rot or will make the gel formation becomes like a blob. Okay, I think that is all from me, and fish products ends it all. Thank you.